morning, Brother Bryant is coming, our last speaker of the day, and touched my heart last night.
Amen.
Preaching about the blood, amen.
Amen.
I appreciated that. And I thought of David as he wrote, "Thy word have I hid in my heart," as I listened to Brother Bryant preach last night. God has allowed him to hide his word in his heart. I appreciate that. Brother Bryant, come preach to us.
Amen. Right.
Well, I appreciate the good preaching I've heard thus far this morning. I've known Brother McDivitt for a long time. Had the privilege of preaching his church last fall. It's a good church, good people. And I'm glad that I was able to hear him again today. It's good to have brethren that are just solid, isn't it? Mm-hmm. Solid.
Yeah. Well,
and I appreciate Brother Green. I think that's the second time I've heard him preach, and both times he's been a blessing and an encouragement to me. And so I'm glad I was able to be here today. Good to see you folks. Glad you stuck around to the end. I hope and pray that you have a good day today. I'm going to have a good day today. I'm telling you, in a little while, I'm going to get on a plane and go back south. With all due respect, where people talk right. And I've had just about my fill of folks making fun of my accent. I don't have one. You do. I mean, folks talk right down there. You understand that, don't you? Now, I mean, just sure. Up here you would say, "That was good singing." Now down there you say, "That's good singing." Sure. Y'all know what WAR is, don't you?
War.
Yeah, like a Bob Ward fence. Sure. You know what LARD is, don't you? That's deity. May the Lord bless you, really. I'm sure you've ever had living meringue pie. You know what meringue is, don't you? It's right here on my finger. Now, we've had our English lesson for the day. May the Lord bless you real good. I mean that. God bless you folks, what you do here in this part of the world. Just keep it up until Jesus comes. Like preacher said a minute ago, there's no place to quit.
Amen.
And listen to me, anybody can quit, and the weak always do. Anybody can quit, and the weak always do.
That's right.
Don't quit. No place to quit. But that's not my message. Let me say again, I appreciate the invitation to come and be here. Love you men. God bless you. Keep up the good work. The work is worthy of our best.
Right.
It surely is. Now, I want to talk to you today about this book. I want to talk to you today about word that we have straight from the throne of God. Word that comes to us straight from the throne on high. Last night I talked about the blood. Today I want to talk about the book. And my text would be found in the 138th Psalm in the second verse. And it says, "For thou hast magnified thy word above all thy name." You ever thought about that? It said, God said, "For thou hast magnified thy word above all thy name." God said that he puts this book even above his name. "For thou hast magnified thy word even above all thy name." I think I feel like a prophet who said in Jeremiah 15:16, "Thy words were found, and I did eat them. And thy word was unto me the joy and rejoicing of my heart." And I think I feel like those who said in the 32nd chapter of Exodus, "And the writing was the writing of God." Now, I'm glad that I can stand before folks today and tell folks, listen, we have word that comes to us straight from the throne on high.
Amen.
And I'm glad that I can stand before folks today and tell them the writing is the writing of God. Where would we be without this book? We would be left only to guesses. We would be left just to tradition. We would be left only to legend. But with this word, we have infallible instruction that comes to us straight from the throne of God on high. Infallible, inerrant instruction from the throne of God on high. And I agree with Brother McDivitt, who said, for English-speaking people, I'm talking about the old King James Bible.
That's right.
The authorized version, that's the only one we teach from on the campus of the Arthur Baptist College. It's the only one we recommend. It's the only one we sell in our bookstore. Last spring, spring we had a KJV conference, and I believe Ringley Speaking People, the Word of God, the infallible, inerrant Word of God is the old authorized version, the King James Bible. The other English translations come from a corrupt line of manuscripts,
Amen.
And they are weak, inferior,
right.
and not worthy to be considered the Word of God.
That's right.
And so I'm glad that I can stand before folks and say, we do have the Word of God. We have Word straight from the throne on high. And you keep in mind this, in 112th Psalm, God said, in the 12th Psalm, God said that He would preserve His Word. He said He would preserve His Word from that generation forever. He said He would preserve His Word from that generation forever. Now, we don't have the originals anymore. They're not around. We don't have them. Now, God said He would preserve His Word. Where is it?
That's right.
It has to be somewhere.
Right.
He said He would preserve it, and we don't have the originals anymore. Where is it? It has to be somewhere, or God didn't keep His Word.
Right.
Now, if He preserved it, where is it? Let me say again, it has to be somewhere. And I believe, Ringley Speaking People, it's on the pages of the old authorized version,
Amen.
The King James Bible. And so, I've got that we have the Word of God today. Where would we be without it? We'd be sunk. We'd be in big trouble. As I said a moment ago, left only to tradition or guesses or legend. But we have the Word of God. And He said He has magnified it even above all of His name. What's the Bible mean to you? What the Bible means to people in our churches. You know, the truth of the matter is, what the Bible means to people shows.
That's right.
It shows in the way they live.
Amen.
It shows in the places they go.
That's right.
It shows in the way they talk. It shows in how they live. And it's a sad thing to me that in many of our churches today, many of our independent, fundamental, Bible-believing, missionary-minded, evangelistic, soul-winning, friendly, red-letter, edition, nary a piece of literature Baptist. What the world out there, to respect the book, that they themselves neglect.
That's right.
Did you hear me?
Right.
They want the world to respect the book that they themselves neglect.
That's right.
The brother mentioned a moment ago the fact that I quote a lot of scripture when I preach, and I've had people say to me at times over the years, "How do you memorize so much scripture?" And my reply is, "I thought we were supposed to." I thought we were supposed to.
Amen.
He says, "Thy word have I hid in my heart." Now, folks, that's memorization.
That's right.
"Thy word have I hid in my heart, that I might not sin against thee." What does the Bible mean to us? And the truth of the matter is, it shows. Did you ever notice? Let's see up here. Oh, wow. Did you ever notice that there are probably people up here in your churches that can tell you all about the Cincinnati Reds, and I love the Reds. I'm a Red fan. I love the Reds. I love the Indians. I really do. I'm a sports fan. I used to love the team that was called the Cleveland Browns.
That's right.
I don't pull for the Baltimore Ravens.
That's right.
Amen. I lived and died with the Browns when I grew up over here in Dayton. Did you ever notice there's and now I follow the Bengals too. But did you ever notice there's probably people in your churches, I can guarantee you there's people in churches in Texas, that can tell you all about the Dallas Cowboys, tell you all about the Dallas Mavericks, tell you all about the Texas Rangers. You probably got people up here that can name the starting lineup for the Cleveland Indians. You probably got people up here that can name the starting lineup for the Cincinnati Reds, the starting lineup for the Cincinnati Bengals, tell you who plays every position, tell you what college they came from, how long they've been in the league. They can tell you all about who bats lead off and who bats second and who bats cleanup. They can tell you all about their averages, tell you about their RBIs, tell you about the pitchers and their ERAs and all that stuff. And they can't, and they're in our churches, and yet they can't quote 10 verses of scripture. Now, something wrong.
Right.
Something is bad wrong in people's hearts when they can memorize other stuff, but they don't memorize the Word of God, and they want the world out there to respect a book that they themselves neglect.
Right.
Oh, but listen, God said, He said He's magnified His Word even above all of His name. I want to tell you that we ought to feel like the psalmist who said in the 119th Psalm, verse 140, "Thy word is very pure, and therefore thy servant loveth it." We ought to feel like the psalmist who said in the 119th Psalm, in the 162nd verse, "I rejoice in thy word as one that findeth great spoil." I want to say that the best advice we could ever give anyone is read your Bible.
Amen.
Read your Bible.
Amen.
Learn your Bible. Memorize your Bible. Learn how to apply your Bible. Isaiah 34:16. "Seek ye out the book of the Lord and read." 2 Timothy 2:15. "Study to show thyself approved unto God." Suggesting if we don't study, were not approved unto God.
Amen.
Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, suggesting if we don't study, we ought to be ashamed.
That's right.
A workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. And that word study carries with it the thought of a detailed, intense search. So, beloved, the best advice we could ever give anyone is read your Bible, study your Bible, learn your Bible, memorize your Bible, know how to apply your Bible. We must keep in mind that all of our theology is the study of God and the relationship that He sustains with His creation. All of our theology must be based upon, thus saith the Lord.
Amen.
All of our religious activity should be based upon, thus saith the Lord. Why do you do that? Well, because the Bible says. Why do you believe that? Well, because the Bible says. All of our theology and all of our religious activity must be based upon what the Book of God says. This must be our authority. This must be our roadmap as we make our way through life. This, you know, God made man, and then God made a manual for the man that He made. God said, if you want to know how to get the best out of yourself, if you want to know how to get the best out of life, if you want to know what to expect from me, then read the manual. Read the instructions. That's the blueprint. Thy word, hast thou magnified above all thy name. Now, brethren, as preachers of the gospel, I want us to keep in mind some things. I want to say, number one, this book is a living book.
Amen.
This book is a living book.
Amen.
Two scripture references for that, Hebrews 4:12. It says the word of God is quick. And that word quick means alive. The other is 1 Peter 1:23. And it said, being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the word of God which liveth. So it says in Hebrews 4:12, this book is quick. That means it's alive. It says in 1 Peter 1:23, the word of the Lord which liveth, says that it liveth. So I want to tell you, number one, this book is a living book. And I want to say this book just seems to pulsate with the power and breath of the Almighty.
That's right.
This is a living book. You know, one of the preachers this morning made reference to the fact that 2 Timothy 3:16 says, all scripture is given by inspiration of God. And that word inspiration is the word theonoustos, and what it means is the very breath of God. It's that all scripture is given by the breath of God. You see, the words that you are hearing right now are David Bryant-breathed words. We breathe as we speak. And it says all scripture is given by the very breath of God. The very life of God is in this book. This is a living book. Now, living things, of course, produce things. And this book produces. This book produces new life. This book produces hope. This book produces courage. This book produces faith. This book produces goodness. This book produces because this book lives. This is a living book. I want to say, number one, the Bible is a living book. Now I want to say, number two, the Bible is a light-giving book. A light-giving book. And again, two scripture references for that, both from the 119th Psalm. In the 119th Psalm in verse 105, it said, thy word is a lamp. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. And over in Psalm 119, verse 130, it says, the entrance of thy word giveth light. It giveth understanding unto the simple. And so I want to say this book is a light-giving book. The truth of the matter is, you and I know that we dwell in the midst of a world of deep spiritual darkness. We dwell in the midst of a world that doesn't know the Lord. We dwell in the midst of a world that resides in darkness. You and I know in 1 Thessalonians 5, those who are saved are called children of the light, and those who are not saved are called children of the darkness. And so we live in a world of spiritual darkness. And in this world of spiritual darkness, I am so glad that God has given us a light.
That's right.
I'm glad that God has given us a light to shine.
Amen.
As a matter of fact, in 2 Peter 1:19, it says this is like a light that shines in a dark place. Oh, listen, he said, thy word is a lamp unto my feet. That's right here, right now, today, where I am. But he said, it's also a light unto my path. That's out there in front of me. That's for tomorrow and the next day as I go down the road, you see. But did you ever notice? The world always gets it backwards. The world always gets it wrong. And I want to tell you why. It's because they're stumbling around in the darkness.
Right.
We don't have to stumble around in the darkness. We have light. We have information. And so this book, you see, is a living book. This book is a light-giving book. Now I want to say number three. This book is a lasting book. A lasting book. And again, two scripture references. Matthew 24:35. Jesus said, heaven and earth will pass away, but my words shall not pass away. It's just going to last.
Yeah.
The lasting book. And then again, from 1 Peter 1, verse 25, it said, the word of the Lord that endureth forever. The word of the Lord that endureth forever. This is a lasting book. I mean, just think how long this old book's been around.
Amen.
I mean, just think this book was about 1,600 years in the writing. 1,600 years from Genesis to Revelation before it was all written down. 40 different authors used from various and sundry backgrounds they came. 1,600 years. Now we are 2,000 years on the other side of that. That's at least 3,600 years. And still this book remains as powerful as it ever was. Still this book remains as life-changing as it ever was.
Amen.
Still this book can do the miraculous unlike any other book that has ever been written.
Right.
You see, this book is a lasting book. Not only is this book year after year after year the bestseller, it's man's best buy. I remember I read one time about a fellow who took his New Testament to have it to rebound. And because it was so torn up, you see, and so used, and so they rebound the New Testament for him and went back to pick it up. And he went back to pick it up. They didn't on this, what do you call this?
Fine.
Thank you. On the little skinny part here, the little thin part here, not
fine.
Yeah, that's it. It said they didn't write the New Testament. They abbreviated and put TNT. TNT. I thought how appropriate, how fitting and proper TNT. That's what that book is. That book year after year after year after year is dynamite. That book year after year after year is a powerful, lasting book, and it's as powerful as it ever was. I mean, folks, think about it. I look out here and I see some folks with gray hair. I look in the mirror and get out in the sunlight and I see some gray hair right here. My wife would tell me the other day. Oh, yes, bless her soul. About the gray hair that I'm beginning to show up here. My daughter walked in my office the other day and I was sitting there with the sunlight coming in the window, and my daughter walked in my office, walked around behind my chair where I was sitting and the sunlight coming in on my hair, and she said, boy, Daddy, your hair sure is starting to look distinguished. I said, get out of here. Don't you have something better to do? Go pray somewhere or something. Get out of here. Go try to get a blessing with somebody. I look out here and I see some folks with gray hair. I look out here and see some folks that don't have as much as they used to. Now, let me ask you older folks something. I could ask you, how many of you have been saved 25 years? How many have been saved 30 years? How many have been saved 40 years? How many have been saved 50 years? Maybe there's some folks in here been saved that long. Let me ask you something. Does this book mean as much to you today as it did the day you were saved?
Amen.
Does this book as thrill you as much today as it did the day you were saved?
Amen.
And probably we'd say, yes, sir, and even more.
Amen.
You know what that says to me? That says this book is a lasting book. That tells me this book's power and message and authority and blessing never wears out because it's the book of God.
Amen.
Old Voltaire, the noted French infidel, stood one day and said, in a few short years, the Bible will be a forgotten book.
Yeah.
Voltaire died. The American Bible Society bought his house and set up printing presses and print the Bible in the home that he lived in.
Yeah.
I tell you, my friends, this book that God says is magnified, even above all his name, is a living book. And it is a life-giving book. And it is a lasting book. And I want to say number four, it's a loyal book.
Amen.
A loyal book. Scripture references Psalm 119, verse 89. And it says, forever, O Lord, thy word is settled in the heavens.
Amen.
It's a loyal book, and by that I mean it's loyal to itself, will not change.
Yes.
It is a loyal book. It doesn't change. Its message does not change, because after all, its author never changes. Malachi 3 and verse 6, he said, I am the Lord, I change not. Hebrews 13 and 8, it says, Jesus Christ the same, yesterday, today, and forever. Psalm 119 again, verse 89, forever, O Lord, thy word is settled. I'm so thankful in this world that is unsettled, in this world that is unsteady, we have a constant, unchanging, settled standard that does not change.
Amen.
I'm so thankful that this old book never changes and is loyal to itself. Aren't you glad God never has to send us an update or a correction?
Right.
Aren't you glad that God doesn't have to send to us, for example, every now and then something that says, direct from heaven, telegram from the throne, I've made a change. I want you to take out 1 Corinthians chapter 16. Those things are no longer in effect. Aren't you glad that God doesn't send us word every now and then that says, oh, here, I want you to add this. This is Galatians chapter 7. We're going to add some things on the book of Galatians. So chapter 6 is no longer the last chapter. Here's an added chapter 7. I want you to put that in there. Aren't you glad that every now and then God doesn't have to send us word from heaven, for example, to say, now in Revelation 21, I want you to change verse, well, just take out verse number 8. We've changed that. I mean, the fearful and unbelieving. you glad that we have a book that is a loyal book, a constant, unchanging standard that we can build our lives and our eternities on? This is a loyal book, you see. What it first revealed as truth is still truth.
Amen.
I mean, what it first revealed about creation is still truth. The evolutionist is as wrong as he can be.
That's right.
What it first revealed about sin is still truth. The humanist is just as wrong as he can be.
That's right.
What it first revealed about Lucifer is still true. What it first revealed about salvation is still true. What it first revealed about God himself is still true. This is a loyal book. This is a lasting book. This is a life-giving book. This is a living book. I'll say number five. This is a literal book.
Amen.
A literal book. Now, the scripture reference for that would be 2 Peter 1, verse 20. And you and I know what 2 Peter 1, 20 says. No prophecy is of any private interpretation. What that means is quite simply this. Brother Lewis can't read John 3, 16 and then say, now this is what I believe that means. And then Brother Estes read John 3:16, and he says, well, this is what I believe that means, and it's different from what Brother Lewis said he thought it meant. And then Brother Rush read John 3:16 and say, now, this is what I believe that means, and really it's different from what Brother Lewis had said and what Brother Estes had said. And so we have three different ideas about John 3:16 or three different interpretations about John 3:16, and with God, that'd be all right. See, 2 Peter 1:20 said, no, no prophecy is of any private interpretation. That means God meant something when he said that, and God meant one thing when he said that, and God didn't mean 15 or 20 different things when he said that, and he didn't leave it up for a man to interpret or a man to tell us what it meant. God meant something when he said it. It's a literal book. It's not of any private interpretation. It's a literal book. In other words, the Bible says what it means. It means what it says. We don't need to try and make it mean something else. It's just a literal book. Just take it at face value for what it says, unless common sense or the context tells you otherwise. For example, Jesus said, I'm the door. Now, you and I understand Jesus is not a door. He's not a door with a handle on it. Jesus said, I'm the bread of life. Now, you and I understand Jesus Christ is not a loaf of bread sliced in 15 or 20 pieces. Common sense and the context tells us otherwise. But unless common sense or the context tells you otherwise, it is a literal book. It just means what it says and says what it means. And it's not that hard to figure out. You know, listen, God didn't give us this book and say, now read it and good luck. Hope you can figure out what it means. God said, just read it and believe it and accept it. The critic says, well, it's all a matter of interpretation. And the critic is just as wrong as he can be. God meant something when he said it. It's a literal book. When God said hell and fire, that's what he meant, hell and fire. When God said, the man said, I am tormented in this flame, it didn't mean something else. That's what he meant. When God said in Mark 9, the fire is never quenched and the soul of man never dies, that's exactly what God meant. When God said, you must be born again, that's exactly what he meant. You must be born again. When God said that Jesus Christ is the only way, that's exactly what he meant. Jesus Christ is the only way. When God said there are consequences for sin, be not deceived, God is not mocked, whatsoever man soweth, that shall he also reap. That's exactly what he meant. When God said streets of gold, that's what he meant. When God said living forever, that's what he meant. And so, the Bible, you see, is a literal book. The Bible is a loyal book. The Bible is a lasting book. The Bible is a life-giving book. The Bible is a living book. And then I want to say this, number six. The Bible is a loathed book. L-O-A-T-H-E-D, loathed book. That means hated. Scripture reference is Jeremiah 36. You know the story of Jeremiah. I'm sorry. You know the story of Jeremiah 36. The king is Jehoiakim. And we find that the Baruch, Jeremiah's recording secretary, has been writing down what Jeremiah was dictating to him to write down. Thus saith the Lord, here's the word of God, write this down. No, Baruch's writing it down. And one day Baruch shares some of this with some of the king's religious officials. And they say, let me have that thing. Let me have that. And we're going to see what the king has to say about this. I think the king would be interested in this. Now you tell Jeremiah to go hide out. You let us have this. We're going to take it in. We're going to read it to the king. You know the story. And they go into Jehoiakim. And they say, hey, we got this scroll, this word of God that comes from Jeremiah the prophet. Let's read it. And he said, let me hear it. And he started reading. They started reading. And he read just a little bit. Jehoiakim said, give me that thing. I don't like what that has to say at all. And he took it and threw it in the fire. You remember the story. Point is, he didn't like the word of God. He loathed what the word of God said. He wanted to destroy what the word of God said, and he threw it in the fire. Now, we live in a society just like that today. We live in a society that loathes this book. Couldn't care less what this book says.
That's right.
As a matter of fact, don't like what this book says.
Right.
We live in a humanistic society today that has taken God off the throne and put man on the throne.
That's
right. We live in a society today that says man will come up with all of the answers, man will find all of the solutions, man will solve all of the riddles, man's education, man's ideas, man's technology. We don't need God anymore. It's a humanistic society that does not like the thought of God.
Right.
It's like Romans 1. They do not like to retain God in their knowledge.
That's right.
Why, sure, look at the public school system. You can carry in a book all about witchcraft,
That's right.
But you can't carry in a book about the word about God.
That's right.
Look at the public school system today. Why, they pass out birth control devices in some public schools.
Right.
But you're not allowed to stand in the hallway and say, you ought to refrain because it's a sin because the Bible calls it adultery and fornication.
Right.
Well, that'll run you out of the school system.
Right.
You can go to the average public school classroom today, you can put up the sign of the Zodiac on the bulletin board, but you can't put up the Ten Commandments.
That's right.
I'm telling you, this book is a loathed book.
Amen.
We live in a society today that the homosexuals parade up and down the streets and have their parades with their placards and demand that you and I look upon their lifestyle as just an alternative and acceptable lifestyle, and they're proud. They're proud of their unnatural affection and lifestyle.
Hey.
You tell them the book of God says, and they'll run you off the street corner.
That's right.
We live in a society today that's legalized murder, and they call it abortion.
Right.
I saw a bumper sticker the other day that said the most dangerous place in the United States of America is in a woman's womb.
That's right.
She doesn't want you, she'll just abort you. Isn't it strange? Isn't it strange that you can abort, as they say, a baby inside the mother, and they call it abortion. But if you do it the second after it's born, they call it murder.
Yeah.
It's just a change of locales. We live in a society today that loathes this book and what this book teaches.
Right.
We live in a society today that's kicked God out. We live in a society today that wants to chart their own way across the sea of life. And they say, no one will be the master of my ship. I'll be the master of my own ship, and I'll chart my own course, and I better not have anybody telling me what's right and what's wrong, what to do and what not to do, because they loathe this book. We live in a, this book is a loathed book. Just start quoting it, preaching on street corners. You'll find out it's a loathed book. And then I come to this last thought. Not only is the Bible a living book, thank God for that, a life-giving book, thank God for that, a lasting book, thank God for that, a loyal book, thank God for that, and a literal book, thank God for that. The Bible is also a loathed book, but number seven, the Bible is a loved book.
Amen.
This is where we come in.
Amen.
God has his people. I'm glad I'm one of them. God has people that have been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. God has people who hold this book dear to their heart. God has people who love him, his son, his work, his church, and his book.
Amen.
You and I must never forget, people have died to give us this book. This book is not only stained with the blood of the Son of God, but this book is stained with the blood of the martyrs who have gone before us. So we can have the Word of God in our language on the printed page.
Amen. That's right.
This book is a loved book.
Amen.
The poet said, though the cover be worn and though pages be torn, and though places bear traces of tears, yet more precious than gold is this book worn and old that can scatter and shatter my fears.
Right.
This old book is my guide. 'Tis a friend by my side. It will lighten and brighten my way. And each promise I find soothes and gladdens my mind as I read it and heed it each day. To this book I will cling. Of its worth I will sing, though great losses and crosses be mine. For I cannot despair, though surrounded by care, while possessing this blessing divine.
Amen.
Oh, brethren, listen. I'm going back to Texas, and I just believe I'm going to preach this book.
Right.
Some of you going back up here in Central Ohio, just believe and preach this book.
Amen.
Some of you going back over in Southeastern Ohio, just believe and preach and teach this book. Some of you going to Pennsylvania, just believe and preach and teach this book. Some have already gone back to Michigan. I hope they'll just, and I believe they will, believe and preach and teach and stand upon this book. Why not? God said he's magnified it, even above all his name. Now, we all do the same thing.
That's right.
We all do the same thing. God expects us. God expects us to love his book. God expects God help us to do it. The Spirit who wrote this, who lives in us, wants us to put our nose in this book every day.
Amen.
To learn and dig from this gold mine, nuggets of gold, to help us along the way. Just this, and I'm through. I know of a place in South Vietnam where 350 United States Marines were told, at all costs, you maintain U.S. presence upon this hill. It was a strategic high point battlefield, on the battlefield in South Vietnam. The U.S. Marines were told, at all costs, you hold this strategic piece of real estate. And they were able to do it, though there were 3,000 North Vietnamese regulars who they fought against on a daily basis. 350 against 3,000. And the reason they were able to maintain that strategic high point was because daily helicopters would bring in supplies and reinforcements and armaments so that they could hold that position. Early one morning, when it became daylight, and they looked out across the valley, looked out upon those who they'd been fighting against for over 6 weeks holding this piece of real estate, they realized that their fate had been sealed. Their death warrant had been signed because they could see now the North Vietnamese had acquired, sometime during the darkness of the night, ground-to-air missiles. And they knew that because they had ground-to-air missiles, that they would be able to destroy the helicopters that were bringing in reinforcements, bringing in the armaments that they needed, and bringing in the supplies that they needed. And in just 2 days' time, 350 Marines had dwindled down to 16. There were only 16 left. Now, our armed forces had tried to bring in reinforcements and armaments and supplies, but ground-air missiles had shot them down every time without fail. A number of pilots had lost their lives and crew chiefs. Now 16 men were left. And they knew it was getting dark, and they knew that sometime during the night or at the first morning light, they would be overrun. They would all be killed. They had a little meeting. A few of the men were Christians. They gave their testimonies to the others. They had a prayer meeting. There was one man in the group who had a son born to him, his dear wife, after he had left Vietnam. He never saw the boy except in a picture. He never touched him, never kissed him on the cheek, never held him in his arms, and he knew he'd never see that little boy. That man wrote two letters that night. He wrote one to his wife, and he thanked her for being a good wife. He told her how much he loved her. He told her that he'd see her in heaven one day. He reminded her that he was a Christian. He trusted Christ as his Savior and tried to reassure her in that regard. He said some loving things to her. He said, make sure and tell my boy that I died a good soldier. Make sure and tell my boy that I died to provide liberty and freedom. And then he wrote a letter to that little boy. He told that little boy that he loved him, that he was sorry he'd never meet him until he got to heaven. And he told his little boy that he wanted him to know that he died fighting to give others freedom. He told that little boy he wanted him to be a Christian when he grew up, that he'd see him in heaven one day. And he took those two letters and he put them under his shirt. They were overrun shortly thereafter, and they all lost their lives. Just a few days later, the Marine Corps came back and reclaimed that hill. They found the bodies of those, and they found these letters. They sent the man's personal effects home to his wife and those two letters. Now, the wife took that letter that he had written to the little boy. It had bullet holes in it. It had blood stains on it. She took that letter and she put it in a frame. And she set that letter there on the table beside that little baby boy's crib. Now, don't you know, as that little boy grew up over the years, that letter from his daddy became one of the most prized possessions that little boy could possibly own. Don't you know that little boy looked at that letter and that little boy read that letter again and again? That little boy had that letter memorized. That little boy probably had everything about that letter memorized and in his heart that his daddy had written to Now, I said all that to say this. We have a letter.
Amen.
We have a letter written to us from a good soldier.
Amen.
He is called the captain of our salvation.
Amen.
And this letter that he has written to us, this love letter that he has written to us, is stained with his blood. Now, I ask all of us here today, does this letter mean as much to us as no doubt that letter came to mean to that little boy as he was growing up? And I pray, old friends of mine, that this letter will mean at least that much to us.
Amen.
It comes to us from one who gave his life to provide freedom.
Amen.
Who gave his life to provide cleansing from sin. Who gave his life that we might live and have a productive life and live forever with him one day.
That's right.
Let it not be forgotten, he said, that he has magnified his word even above all of his name. Let's make sure that we do the same things in our ministries and with our people.